director of the institute, Professor Sangal, the chairman of the institute lecture series, Professor Sanjay, and all the friends here. I'm normally very uncomfortable standing behind the podium, so I'd rather walk around and talk. But let me see if I can manage to stand here long enough to deliver the entire lecture. I'm also very uncomfortable using PowerPoint. But then I was tempted to come out with a PowerPoint for two reasons. One, nowadays every lecture seems to be there with a PowerPoint. So I always hope that I can make powerful points rather than just PowerPoints. But today I thought, let me use it. The second reason is, I was tempted to use part of a presentation that I made to the Honorable Prime Minister of India with the hope that he would possibly see development from my eyes. And when I got an invitation from BHU, I thought, I'm going to his constituency. Heck, why not? Let me share what I told him to the people of his constituency also. And see if you people, the next time he comes, can put pressure on him to see development my way, rather than the way the country seems to be seeing development now. So full disclosures, I'm not a fan of the economic growth model that is tom-tomed around the world. 8% growth in India must be doing very well. So I'm not really a fan of that. So that's the first disclosure. So most of what I speak is from experience. So I'm a practitioner. Though I teach at different places, it's fascinating that universities around the world are now looking to practitioners becoming academicians. So that's the way we can actually bring what really happens to the classroom. And hopefully, I say, the learnings we get from the classroom, we can take it back to the field. So that's how I would look at it. And so my journey, like Professor Sharma said, I started off when I was 19, a young medical student. I really thought I can change the world. I thought I can be the next Albert Schweitzer, go into the forests of India and everything will change. For those of you who are thinking of on those lines, please do think. But you can temper your appreciation of changing the world, because what I finally learned after 32 years of doing that is I have changed myself a lot. And I think that is what is practical, and that's what happens. And my own journey of development, now, if I were to ask you a question, what does development mean? And anyway, we are small enough for you to answer. What would development mean to any of us? All of you would like to have development, right? So what does development mean? I traveled through Varanasi today, and suddenly it occurred to me that if Varanasi can be cleaned up, anybody who attempts that deserves to be the Prime Minister of this country for the rest of his life. And I was wondering, what can we do to clean it up? What is, can we really do anything at all? Can we really ever clean up Varanasi? I believe it can, and that's my model of development. And that is why it's so separated. It's not about spending money. It's not about bringing in all the trucks to clean all the filth of this place. It's something deeper. And it's a deeper thing is what I would like to share. So my whole journey started many, many years ago. I was a young, fresh graduate, 21 years old. Gold medalist from Mysore University. I really thought I knew medicine and I know it very well. So we're going to this forest and you'll be surprised, nobody cared about me. Now imagine you're a professional who believe the doctor, the people are waiting to receive you as God. I had this utopian dream that people will fall at your feet and say, Aage, Bhagwan Aage, and they'll all worship you because you're a doctor. Nobody cared. And that is when I realized how many of us seek at that age. Though we think we are all giving up a lot, actually we are giving up nothing. We are actually seeking all the time and seeking the affirmation of communities that you want to work for, seeking their blessings and seeking their support and their worship and their gratitude. And that is not service at all, that I learned later on. But at that point of time, I thought people should accept me as a doctor. So hungry for patients. I was hoping, why are the tribals falling sick? It is the middle of a forest. No access to anything, no roads, no buses, no electricity, no water. I was living in a small hut. And people not falling sick. Just imagine what kind of a future I would have had. I thought there is no business here at all for a doctor. I wasn't even charging money, but the affirmation, the ego affirmation that you get when somebody is actually sick and vulnerable and you treat. I was hungry for that and nothing was happening. And suddenly in December 1987, I get a call from a tribal colony, I get to know that one woman was about to deliver a baby. And I thought, this is my chance. I can now go prove I'm a doctor. If I go deliver that baby, everybody will accept I'm a doctor. And to make matters much better for me, she was a daughter of the chieftain. We call him Ejmana. Ejman ki beti. So daughter of the chieftain. So I thought, oh my God, if I develop the chieftain's daughter, I'm accepted now. Everybody worship me. So 7:30 in the evening, I go to that small tribal colony, 4 houses, that's all. And remember, these are people who have been punished in the name of development. This country of ours, with no resettlement and rehabilitation policy even today, for the indigenous communities who lived all their lives in the forest, sacrificed their everything for us who live outside the forest. Their land, their water, everything. Jal, jungle, jameen, all of that is gone for us. 4 dams were built where they lived, the area I went to. 4 major reservoirs supplying water to the city of Bangalore, producing electricity to the city of Bangalore, and they live on the banks of the river with no drinking water. They live on the same banks of the river with no electricity at all. You know, Karnataka is a strange state, apart from being possibly one of the most corrupt states in India today, with no governments at all. Still, they are surviving. That's the beauty of Karnataka. We also are a state where 54% of the consumption of power in the state of Karnataka is the city of Bangalore alone. So, remaining parts of Karnataka, Bangalore is just 1/6 the population of Karnataka, consumes more than half the electricity produced and used in the city of the state of Karnataka. Obviously, the rest of Karnataka is never going to develop. We don't ask these difficult questions. When we say 8% growth, none of us ask who's contributing to the 8% growth. Because this law of averages, if you are making ₹1,000,000 and I am making 10 rupees, between the two of us, we are making ₹500,000 and ₹5. So everybody is happy. The country is progressing a lot. So, and we publish those figures, they all are happy. And we don't ask questions. We never ask questions. That's a tragedy of Indian citizenship. Indian citizenship is dead. We are still subjects of a benevolent crown and we never become citizens of a great country of ours. And that's what my book, which brought me to IIT-BHU. Strangely, professor, the director read my book and then he wrote to me and said, you should come and speak. And I thought, maybe I should come. And that's how the relationship began. And here I am. It's called I, the Citizen. How as ordinary people, we can make an extraordinary difference in this great country of ours. And that's what I want to spend talking about. What I believe is a development vision for this country. So this person, I heard that's about to deliver. I go to the tribal colony. And in a tribal system, there is a, which is more or less common throughout the country. Without the Ejmana's permission, the chieftain's permission, you don't enter the colony, the tribal colony. And without the permission of the mother, you don't enter the house. It's a very simple rule, the matriarchal, matrilineal system they have. So I went there and my shock was this child was 14 years old and she was pregnant. Pregnant is the first child. And half of me said, what a great thing to happen. Because if you're pregnant at 14, we call them high-risk pregnancies. Which means they need a doctor. And so I can show I'm a doctor. But the other side of me said, what the hell? How can a girl at 14 get pregnant? How fair is it? Something is wrong in this country. But then I thought, forget the wrong. I'll look at it later. Let me first deliver this girl and be called a hero for everybody here. So I examined her. She was the first pregnancy. So we call it primi gravida. And she was early labor. So normally textbooks tell us it takes 24 hours for the labor to progress. So I thought, it's a project tiger area, evenings there are tigers, leopards, elephants, so why get stuck there? Let me come back. You know, we doctors always look at the convenience of ourselves rather than the patient most of the time. So I was also in the same phase at that time. I just came back and said, tomorrow morning, let me go check her once more. Next morning, I was going 6:30. Like I said, I lived in the place where it was Asia's largest elephant corridor. So around 6,000 elephants migrate from all parts of the Western Ghats to the river, which is where I live. And after the summer, they would go back. So this was the going back phase. And before the next summer starts, and then they come back in after 3-4 months again back to the river. So I was in a very apprehensive way walking towards the colony again. And one elderly lady, she told me, where are you going so early? And I told her, I'm going to go deliver Madi. And she said, why would you want to go? There's no need to go. The child was born last night itself. Now, I was really mad. Why the hell couldn't this baby wait as per the textbook for 24 hours? Why did that have to come so fast? Now, I lost the only chance I had to prove I'm a doctor. But I had to somehow show I'm a doctor. So I thought, okay, my professor had told me, nowadays you don't even get those medicines. You know, we always think everything old is bad. That's a tragedy of science. Science never condemns the past. It is we, in our interpretation of science, we either condemn the past or romanticize on it and say everything is good. Both are bad. So we have something called gentian violet. I don't even know if you use this chemical nowadays. I'm talking in the chemical engineering department. I don't know if gentian violet students of medical students today never even know that. We used to apply that on umbilical stump. One of the finest antiseptics you can have. But nowadays, because it is so cheap, nobody will want it. For 1 rupee, you'll get so much. So it can't be good enough. You know, you have to spend 1,000 rupees and everybody is good. Medicine is very good. And apply some gentian eye drops to the eyes. So I just was going there. So let me do that and come. Show I'm a doctor. So I go to this hut. I'm sitting, standing outside the hut. And telling this young girl, please come and show me your baby so that I can put some eye drops and put some gentian violet. 3-4 minutes I kept saying, please come out, please come out. Nothing happened. No noise at all. No, try talking to somebody who doesn't talk to you at all. That's a fascinating way of diffusing tension. So I used to earlier teach a course on negotiation. So I said the tribal method of negotiation is just stay quiet. When you stay quiet, what do you do now? You neither know whether he's agreeing with you or disagreeing with you. You should try this on your deans or director sometime, the students here. It actually works. Only problem is they also start trying it on you, then it's miserable. So this girl was not answering. I was feeling very nervous. 5 minutes later, I said, come out in Kannada. She was not coming. 10 minutes later, in desperation, I said, if you don't come out and show me the baby, I am going to come inside and see the baby. And then what she screamed, it is still as though it happened yesterday to me. Possibly the most important incident that changed my life. And it's a very private incident, so I hardly share it. But today, since I started talking, I wanted to share it. That girl screamed, please don't come inside. I have nothing to wear on my body. This is 1987, my friends. 40 years of so-called political, socio-economic freedom. A young girl of this country delivering her own baby in the forest in the middle of the night, cutting the umbilical stump with a bamboo shoot, delivering her own placenta, and the process of delivering the placenta soils the only sari she's wearing, gets up in the night, washes it, and she's put it on the hut for the sun to come out and dry. And only after the sun dried the piece of sari she had, she could wear it back again. Otherwise, she was stark naked till then. Imagine a country where we worship Sita, Lakshmi, Durga and all these things and fight about it. A country which cannot provide a sari to wear for a young girl who just delivered. I thought I wanted to give up medicine and go back. My whole family lives in the US, so I thought I should also go there. I made this mistake of coming to the forest. Maybe I can't take it. Medical college didn't prepare me. I was very impressed to hear about the values courses I was hearing about. And I think it's such a critical component. Between 17 and 21, if young children of today can be shared with this extraordinary concepts like aspiration, dreams, etc. It can really make a difference 20, 30 years from today. We'll never recognize it. Nobody taught me all that. And so I was feeling so frustrated and I wanted to give up. I said, let me go back to what is very comforting to me, to America. But then, once you read Vivekananda himself says, I am like a seed which once dropped into your body can never exit. That power and the enormity of what he gives each one of us. I think every young Indian should read. What changed my life are two small books. And maybe they should become part of the curriculum for a value education. Two small books. One book is called To the Youth of India. Maybe 5 rupees or 10 rupees sold by the Ramakrishna Mission. Another book is called His Call to the Nation. How every young man who being educated at people's expense, now, whether you like it or not, whether you agree with me or not, whether the fees of IIT is increased and you talk about it or not, I am paying for a lot of fees of the students here. Every Indian and the taxation revenues we are contributing is what sustains the IITs and IIMs. And so you have a responsibility to give back to us, to this country. And that's the vision I want to share, how you can do it. You don't have to do it by coming to the forest with me. This young child, remember, that moment of time I felt there should be no Mahdi in India. There can never be a Mahdi we can all accept. There should be no young woman who has to have the life that she lived. And that day I thought development is about building hospitals, building schools, building toilets, getting drinking water. I am not saying all of that is not development. Don't get me wrong. I started my journey that way. I built 2 hospitals, 2 schools, mobile health units, a lot of things. Like my introduction, they said today our project reached out to 1 million people. But the difference today than what it was 30 years ago is we approach development differently. So I was fascinated. After doing all this for 15 years, I still feel people are the same. There's no difference. People still fall sick. They come to me, I treat them, they go back home, they fall sick. People drink water, they fall sick, they come back, I make the water better, again they fall sick. Somehow nothing changed. Except that I built a big institution, I didn't see anything else change. So I was puzzled. What does development mean? Why aren't things changing? The amount of money that the government of Karnataka spent on tribal development those days, I had calculated in 1990. Basically, at heart, I'm a researcher. And I found out that if all the money spent in the name of tribal development from 50s had been kept together in a bank deposit, every tribal family could have been given those days in 90s itself 5,000 rupees per month, check, with interest alone. And they would have been better off. Then, and every year we spend thousands of crores on tribal development. I don't know where it goes. So what is wrong? Where do we begin? So these were the questions I had. So my questions were about development itself. What is development? Is it the roads we build, the national highways we create, the extraordinary vehicles we have today? Is it financial inclusion? Is it stand-up India? Is it startup India? Is it mudra? Maybe it's all that. But is it that alone? So my paradigm is different. So I'll be sharing with you what my paradigm is and what the promise of development. So I had a few questions that I was wrestling with. Can development truly be based on people's aspirations? I had a very fine incident which I quote in my book. The national park was being formed and the people were all being discussed with. The forest officer who's in charge of rehabilitation was trying to tell tribals, please come out of the forest. 5 lakh milega aapko. 5 lakhs in terms of compensation. You'll get a house, you'll get land, you'll get everything. He described so beautifully paradise. And an elderly tribal woman got up and politely asked the forest officer, will I get dry firewood if I come outside? This question seems insignificant for us because we don't know what dry firewood is for. For that lady, all her life revolved around finding dry firewood to cook every day. Because we live in a dry deciduous forest with 6 months of rainfall, most of the time firewood is wet. So every morning getting the fire going is a big problem for her. So she said, you'll give me all that, fine. But will you give me some steady supply of dry firewood? The forest officer never understood. He looked at me and said, what kind of people you have? We are giving them so much that they want dry firewood. Amartya Sen, much after he got the Nobel Prize, now suddenly he's woken up and he says, development is not all that we thought. Development is the freedom of choice we can give our individuals. How many of us can get up in this country and say, I have the freedom of choice. I can choose to lead my life the way I want to lead. So can our aspirations define development? Was the question I had. Can development ever be sustainable? Is it really practical? We all live in a world. You know, I was looking at my cell phone. Some 2-3 years ago, somebody gifted me a cell phone. You know, if you're in the voluntary sector like me with no salary, life is very nice. Somebody will give me a jubba. Somebody will give me a phone. Somebody gifted me a Mac laptop also. Especially if you have classmates in abroad, it's very nice. Because the way they can wipe out their guilt is to keep gifting me something. And they do it and I take it because I use it also. And I was just looking at my laptop and my assistant told my phone. She said, your battery is gone, sir. It doesn't come 3 hours. You should change the phone. I said, why change the phone? Why can't we change the battery? She said, no, you don't know, you are a different generation. Nobody changes batteries nowadays. You change the cell phone itself. I said, what do you mean? Another cell phone you have to make for changing it for me. She couldn't understand. Now, we live in a world where at least my change is necessary. For some of us, today I have iPhone 5, tomorrow 6 comes out, I'll go buy that. Tomorrow 6X comes out, I'll go buy that. So, we are constantly in this mode of acquisitions. In this mass consumerism, can ever sustainability ever be real? You can have all the SDGs declared, you can meet in Rio, you can meet in New York, all the heads of government can meet and spend our money there. But are they really going to make anything sustainable? Can we truly understand sustainable development? Can we look at it beyond income growth and infrastructure? And historically, this country has seen injustices. I have lived with the tribals. I lived with people who have been mercilessly subjected to enormous injustice. Injustice in the name of development. injustice in the name of building reservoirs, declaring national parks, for all for the benefit of our urban oriented economic engine, and we don't even want to correct it. So I thought somewhere can we address those questions. So I believe development as economic growth has got very limited social advantages, very limited social gains. If you cannot address Mahdi, if you cannot stop a Mahdi from getting pregnant, it is not about having a hospital for Mahdi to deliver when she becomes pregnant. It is about enabling Mahdi not to get pregnant at 14 at all. To me, that was development. Can we really accomplish it? The state may make a law and say women should not get pregnant before 18, but it means nothing in a forest where a Mahdi doesn't even know she is living in a state called India. So what does it make to her? What difference does it have on her? So this is the questions I had. A huge disconnect between policy and program. I remember many, many years ago, the government of Karnataka's industries department came to me. And they said, we want to run a training program for tribals. I said, very good, let's run a training program. What do you want to train them on? They said, mortar rewinding. Imagine, I'm living in a forest, no electricity. Tribals have no concept of a fan or a mixer. I said, what mortar? They said, nice sir, if you repair mixers and fans, they can make a lot of money. For that, first you must have electricity, no? So this is how the government policy is. Somebody sitting in Delhi decides, mortar rewinding for tribals is a good occasional skill. So skill up India. This is how skilling India is made. Without even having the basic capacity to absorb skills. I like what I heard today. English as an instrument of transaction and English as an object of esteem. In our country, whether you like it or not, our economy is driven by English as an instrument of transaction. Now, I can be emotional and say, I learn Hindi, I learn Kannada. But when you want to have the business language, you have no choice but to learn English. All other emotions can be set aside. But if you want culture, then you have to learn your language. That's a different issue. But that's the reality we live in. So how do we actually connect policy and program? How do you tell the policymaker in Delhi that motor rewinding is not what the tribals need? And tribals, I went to them and asked, shall I take up the program? Shall I take up motor rewinding? They told me, please take up, sir. I said, but what will you do after learning motor rewinding? You don't have any motor to repair. They said, you don't know, you are come newly to a tribal colony. For the last 15 years, government has been doing training programs for us. Each training program lasts 6 months. They pay stipend of 300 rupees. So for us, attending the training program has become livelihood. They taught us, it was very nice. First they taught them how to rear sheep. The next training program was how to remove the wool from the sheep. The third program was to make blankets from the sheep's wool. And the sheep can never survive there because any sheep, their leopard will come and eat anywhere. But the tribals will never tell you all that. They quietly stayed quiet. First training program, sheep became food for leopard or for the tribal. Second training program, why worry about it? Program was there. So they told me 22 training programs. We have enjoyed it for 11 years. Why do you want to stop it now? Let them teach us anything. Tomorrow they'll teach us car driving. We learn that also. What does it matter? So it is one training program to another. The disconnect between policy and programs. And we never understand the stakeholders in the game. We don't understand what role the state plays. The fascinating... How many of you have read the Indian Constitution here? Faculty including. I won't embarrass you. Only 3 people, 4 people, 5 people, 6, 7. The rest of you have not. The first lesson, if you are an Indian, is to go read the Indian Constitution. The finest written document you can ever see. The true spirit of the Indian Constitution. If you want to really understand the world of Google today, go Google up the debates of the Constituent Assembly. What fine minds spoke and debated for such a long time. A lot of my work has revolved on comparative analysis of the Indian Constitution. No country in the world, I can tell you, except nowadays, a lot of new countries are experimenting. Recently, Thailand is trying to get a new constitution. Sudan, South Sudan has got a new constitution. South Africa has got a new constitution. But then, no country has got such a long constitution. It is not a constitution that defines governance for this country. It's a brilliant document that outlines social re-engineering that this country needs. And if you had lived up to this Indian constitution for the last 50 years, there would have been peace and harmony in India today. But we'll never do it because we don't want peace and harmony. That's a strange part of India. And so to me, development is not the roads, the buildings, IMR, MMR and all that. To me, development is a constant expansion of human capability. If you can constantly expand human capability, wherever they are, whoever they are, that is development. And how does it practically look like? So to me, it should reflect the voice of the people for whom we are working. And I believe fundamental premises I would like to base my discussion for the narrative for India's refashioning India's development narrative is to look at it as a not just the expansion of capability, but something deeper, expanding human and social capital. Why did I think about this? Let me give you a little, a different narrative now. How many of you have heard the name Angus Madison? Okay. There are no economists in this room, so maybe it is good. Because economists rarely agree with me, or I rarely agree with economists, so it's okay. So Angus Madison actually is an economic historian from Britain. He passed away 3-4 years ago. Brilliant elderly man. Some 10-12 years ago, the OECD group of countries suddenly woke up and asked a very simple question. The question is very simple. The whole world is going through an economic collapse, at least a financial collapse. So it's a big challenge. And this financial collapse has been happening for the last so many years. It's not new. It keeps happening as cycles. So their question was simple. They asked Angus Madison, who's an economic historian, to look at the history of economic history of the last 2000 years of this world, post-Christ to 2000, 1 AD to 2000 AD. The question was simple. The mandate given to him was, can you actually study countries around the world and ask yourself, is there any country in this world which has consistently grown without falling back, without having an economic depression somewhere? And if it has consistently grown, are there any lessons for us to learn which you can replicate today? Very simple exercise. And Angus Madison discovered some fascinating facts, and that's what I want to talk to you about. First century AD, a country which grew consistently for 100 continuous years. Any guess which country it was? The way I asked the question, the answer is there. Right? India. The second century? So I can keep asking, you can keep answering. Till the 16th century, my friends, first century AD to 1600 AD, the only country in this world which economics is not the only thing, but that's the only thing the West understands. Our econometric measurement is the only thing the Western countries have. That's the only scale they have, so they measure what they can measure. You give a man a hammer, he'll only see nails everywhere. So poor people, they only measured economics. And remember, 1600 continuous years, not one, not two, not 100. The only country in this world which consistently grew and had close to 36% of global GDP was India. So we need to ask this question. So a lot of questions are framed. The questions people ask is, if India grew for 1600 years, what happened the next 400? And the easiest answer we give is a very superficial correlation. We say British escape, they looted us, we became poor. What did they take? Kohinoor diamond. What nonsense. One Kohinoor diamond and one peacock throne can make India poor. And if you bring it back, India will become rich again. Now, if this logic is true, if India was supplying all the wealth to the United Kingdom, 1947 when we got our independence, they should become poorer then. Because they were not getting that wealth, right? If you actually measure the economic progress of UK, they became richer after they let go of India. Which means India was draining them. And there are calculations today to show that when the British ruled us, they took away our wealth. They took away substantial wealth. They took away 1.5% of our GNP every year. But what others will not tell you is to run this country, to give us our revenue administration, to give us our army, to give us our police, to sustain law and order, they spent 6% of the GNP. So we actually had 4.5% savings by British ruling us. So if we had been intelligent, we could have told them stay on for 20 more years, become poorer and then go. But we let them go. But the point is, they didn't take away our wealth. What they took away was a fundamental belief in our capability to make wealth. And that is the tragedy of this country, and we have never recovered from the colonization. Even today, we have a problem believing in ourselves. If I were to go to my students and say, this is what the Bhagavad Gita says, this is what the Upanishads say, they say, hey, for telling this, you have to come all the way to Cornell. But if I were, I do some teaching at IIM Bangalore also. So if I were to tell them this, they say, you don't have to come to tell us all that. We know, and they know nothing. Gita is probably a friend of a girl, they think they know. But if I give them a citation, a reference of a Henderson, Mandelson, Gunderson, oh, this must be true then. Even today, we are burdened with a tragedy that most scientific textbooks of higher education is not written by our people. We have to get them. Our own professors, I can challenge you, I'm sitting in a hall of IIT professors here. You can go back to the reading material you prescribe. and possibly more than 50% would be some Westerner. What a tragedy we live. The best of brains around the world came from this country, and we don't have faith in ourselves. That's what Vivekananda said. Faith, faith, faith in ourselves. That's the development narrative we are the fashion for this country today. We can change the world, not just India. 1600 years, my friend, every single attainment of human endeavor, whether the discovery of the binary system, to metallurgy, to astrophysics, to astronomy, came from India. Post-1600, nothing has come from India. What we have lost is our capacity to make knowledge. What we have lost is true esteem. And that's why I was very impressed when you said you teach your students esteem. We need collective esteem that this country is wired for greatness. We just have lost our way for 300, 400 years and deliberately made us lose our way with the hijacking of our education system and destroying it. Even making policies in this country could never recover from. I can tell you, you cannot get a greater trader than a Marwadi. 1730, the last time things were calculated in this country, the share of India's share of global trade, my friends, was 20%. 20% of trade happening in the world came from India. Our ships, even before the Westerners understood Archimedes' principle, they think Archimedes discovered it because he shouted Eureka. We were actually running our ships already. We already knew what it was to float on. China and India, two civilizations, which control 68% of global GDP between them, actually were using ships to trade. Westerners didn't learn of it. Much later they learned. And we had 20% share of global trade. By 1810, in just 80 years, because of British policies, our share of world trade came down to 2%. By 1947, it was 0.5%. And we are still recovering now. And we had to go with a begging bowl everywhere? I don't think so. You know why they changed it? One small policy the Britishers did, very, very nicely done. They knew that the only way to disincentivize Indian tradesmen, disincentivize Indian traders in the Vaishya community and the Marwadis, was to make it less profitable. Very simple. Everybody exists for profit. The law, rational law of making profits. But what did they do? They said if you have to use ships to trade, you can only use ships made in London, England. And where do they make it? How do they make it? They make it by taking teak wood from the forest of Karnataka. What intelligent. That's why they built the railway system. They didn't build railway system for you and I to travel. Look at all the points before 1947. It is all trade routes the Britishers built. To ports and to wherever they could procure material and then shift it finally to London. And we credit them in our history. They gave us the railway system. What nonsense. We don't even know what is history today. Vasco da Gama in his own journal. Now if I were to say today all this, they will say I am a romanticist who loves India. I do love India and I have no problem with that. But I am a very, very evidential romanticist. I can give you a lot of evidence to prove that my romance is not misplaced. Vasco da Gama in his journal writes, I thought I was a great adventurer who has got the biggest ship that man has ever built. And I was so afraid of losing my way that I would only travel as far from the ocean as much as I could see the land margin. If he did not see the land, he would not travel, go beyond it. He was so afraid. And he wrote, as I turned round the Cape of Good Hope in Africa, suddenly from the ocean I saw tens of ships coming, each one 10 times my ship size. I was so nervous and I thought, who can these people be? They're coming from outside this world itself, they're coming from the ocean. When they came towards me, I realized there were people like you and me. When I spoke to them, they were so warm and friendly and they asked me, do you want to really know how to do all this? Come to our country. And they took me to Kozhikode. And so Vasco da Gama writes, I was invited to this great country called India. But what do you and I read? Vasco da Gama discovered India. What nonsense. We invited him to India. That is the technology we had. That's the power of trade we had. We would go everywhere. Rajaraja Chola, a king in Tanjore, never had a boundary around the ocean from his kingdom, but he had a navy. Look at the farsightedness of that man. He went all over the world to conquer, at least to trade, to protect his tradesmen. That's what he said. He didn't go to build his empire. Extraordinary country. What happened? So my argument, when I've done a lot of work looking deep into Angus Madison's work, is not to look at the economic growth we had, but ask a fundamental question. If we were the largest GDP in this world, what caused us to be the largest GDP? What created the largest GDP? If we can figure out that secret and replay it now, maybe we can still be the largest GDP and be a great country together. So my argument is, it is not about economic capital. It is not about the benefits that will trickle down after the economy grows at 8%. But it's about building the people who can make the wealth for this country. And creating that human and social capital is what this country did for 1600 years. 1600 years, our focus was not making money. Our focus was on building people. And that is the greatness of this country. So to me, human capital, you define it in many different ways. Economists define it differently. Sociologists define it differently. These are my definitions. And my definition is a set of physical. It's very simple. Heart, body, mind and soul. That's what India focused on. They focus on the body. Which country in the world can think of a science called Ayurveda, tell me? The science of wellness. Unfortunately, I was trained to treat the science, trained in the science of treating the diseased. If you are not unhealthy, I have no job to do. What a strange philosophy. Everybody should fall sick. In fact, when you come to my clinic, I will be telling people, don't smoke, don't drink. But imagine if you really stop smoking and drinking, then what I do? I have no business at all. I want you to smoke. I want you to kill yourself. Only then I have a job to do. But Ayurveda talks of science of wellness. What an extraordinary concept. Ahara Tattva. The science of food. India had a science of food. How to cook, what to eat. How much to eat, how much not to eat. The Bhagavad Gita talks of moderation in everything. Today we talk of moderation. Patanjali's Yoga Sutras today are being validated by fMRIs that neuroscience talks about. But Patanjali wrote it long ago with no dissection at all. Imagine the knowledge we had, but we don't want to credit all of them, no? Because if I say Patanjali, you laugh at me. If I say the latest neuroscience connectome project that's happening now around the world, we'll say, oh, that must be true. Because connectome, how much effort they put in there? A few billion dollars worth project must be doing something. The set of physical, intellectual, emotional and spiritual capabilities that an individual has to afford him or her the agency to lead and sustain life. It should give me the agency. I should decide. Look at the Gurukula system of India. We are the only country in education, my friends, which taught about reflective thinking and repetitive thinking coexisting together in building a person. They would recite the mantras or the sutras continuously without understanding anything for 2 hours. After that, there's nothing else to do except think on it. Today, reflective education in our country is a disaster. Because the British destroyed it. If Indians were reflecting, they couldn't have ruled us. They wanted us to repeat what they told us. We are incapable of running our country. We are all incapable of standing up and facing up anything. We are all very inefficient, slow people. And they sort of brainwashed a generation of people to actually think low of themselves. Vivekananda said that is the curse of India. We are made to believe that they are not capable of anything. India is useless. Can we as a new generation now tell our people that what we can truly achieve? This is a country which achieved so much. Social capital is the benefits that you can get by transacting in the social networks that you have. I am here because you are getting the benefit of the social network that you directly created with me. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here. As simple as that. They are all constantly building social networks. How do you create it? So to me, the domains are physical, intellectual, emotional, spiritual. Look at it. They understood a body needs exercise. They understood a body needs food. Yoga is the greatest exercise that you can give. And I can give you a Western citation again, like I said, 8 months ago. Because if I give the citations of S. Vyasa in Bangalore, they'll say this fellow knows them. That's why he's giving their citations. Harvard Medical School has done a study and says, the best possible human exercise that is conceived for the body is yoga. How many of you here honestly answer me? Practice yoga every day. Imagine 6 hands out of 50 people, 12%. And we gave yoga to the world. And the Prime Minister said International Yoga Day. And it has become a $30 billion yoga industry in America alone. And we are still waking up. They come all the way to Banaras to learn yoga and go back. They come to Mysore to learn yoga and people in Banaras don't do yoga. That is for others. That is for international, not for us. If every Indian could do yoga, just imagine. Health is a reality for all of us. If you can eat the food that our Ahara Tattva says, cook food less, eat natural food, eat less of animal protein, 6 natural colors on your plate every day. That's all you need to follow. You can never fall sick. and yoga half an hour a day. Harvard says half an hour every alternate day. If you can just do Surya Namaskars every day, you will never want a doctor at all. But we don't believe in that. So this is what India offered. We offered that human capital. Look at the reflective and repetitive thinking. Today we created a generation of repetitive thinkers. Last year I was in IIT Chennai, and the director, Mr. Bhaskar, was telling me 40% students fail in the first semester. I don't know how it is here. He says maths and science, maths and physics, I think mostly. That's what he was sharing. And he said, because they are all trained to crack the code of the entrance exam. They don't understand maths and physics. When they have come here, they have to understand. And our professors want them to understand, but they will repeat what the professor says. But understanding, that will come later. And then it's a big challenge for us to get them to understand that. We spent 2 semesters getting them to think differently. And I thought, my God, and Roorkee, last year I was in Roorkee also, and unfortunately they had to fail and then take them back. And this year also they failed. I don't know whether they'll take them back now. But it's not, I'm not making fun of our abilities. All I'm training is, can we reflect? In my course, every day after my class, people would write a reflection note. And I don't take undergrads, but now I teach undergrads in the US. A 19-year-old, 20-year-old attends my class. If you read this reflection note, it's remarkable. I come to some of the best business schools in this country and teach. I ask them to write a reflection note. They'll perfectly reproduce what I told in class. And they think they did a damn good job. They'll come and ask me, sir, I wrote exactly what you taught. Why can't I get an A? That's exactly why they will not get an A. Because it is not about telling what I told in class. It's about what I told, how does it impact you, your thinking, your feelings, and your subsequent action in life. That is reflection. And we were the country which told the world what reflective thinking was. What a tragedy. That is the India we have to recreate now. The enormous human and social capital that we focused on. And that had economic consequences. Not the other way around, my friends. Last year I was in Jharkhand. A 30-year-old tribal, Mal Pahadiya tribal. Fascinating young woman. Very, no, we have a stereotypical image of tribals. I myself, having lived with them for 30 years, have a stereotypical image. I saw a very clean, well-dressed, fully jeweled up woman, and I thought she can't be a tribal. I said, aap to adivasi nahi hai. And she spoke to me Mal Pahadiya, language which I don't know, because I have not lived there. Then I thought, oh, she's a tribal. And I asked her, what does she do? And she was the president of the Federation of Tribal Self-Help Groups. And in the course of the conversation, I asked her, such an young woman, such a beautiful looking young woman, talking to a stranger, her mother-in-law wouldn't allow that. I said, does your mother-in-law allow you to participate in self-help group meetings? And she told me, it shocked me, she told me, the day I got married and came home, my mother-in-law told me, if you don't participate in self-help groups, I'll throw you out of the house. We have such mother-in-laws also in India. Why? Because for 30 years, Tata Steel, I advise Tata Steel, that's why I keep going there. Tata Steel was running self-help groups for tribal women, and this tribal woman was a member of the self-help group, and she wanted her daughter-in-law to become a member of the self-help group. Today, she's the president of the self-help group, and after all the conversation, she told me, aap to Tata Steel ke advisor hain? I said, yes. So, aapko thoda influence hoga na Tata Steel mein? I said, yes. In India, everything is influence. Then I asked, why? She said, ek baat bol do un logon ko. Wo accountant logon ko process karna bahut late karte hain. Bills process karne ke. This woman had taken a contract from our self-help group from Tata Steel to dig farm ponds. She had dug 47 farm ponds out of the 50 she had contracted for, and not a rupee was paid to her. So she said, how long can I wait? It's 6 months. Mujhe paisa chahiye. I said, how did you drill 47 then? She said, I had last year's profits. I invested that. In 15 minutes, she told me all her management knowledge, her hydrology knowledge, how much of water is stored in how big a tank. How much, when the rainy season comes, how long if it rains, how long the water will stand. Laws of evaporation, everything she knew. And she is an illiterate 30-year-old woman. And in the conversation, I asked her how many children. She said, I know, you're a doctor, you'll ask me that question. I have only two. One is 11 years old, one is 9 years old. I only got married after 18. Everything, you know, when you do rural tourism, you start getting into the development circuit, people know what to answer you also. If you're from government, the answer will be different. If you are from NGO, the answer is different. If you are a provider, the answer is different. So, we all know our answers. I thought she is giving such answers, but she was not. I was so impressed with this woman. Look at the enormous human capital she had. And she said she hires a sumo every day, goes around, supervises all the construction work and comes back. And I asked her, how much do you earn? She never answered. 5 minutes I asked, she never answered. Then she, when I was talking alone with her, she said, you should never ask this question so loudly. I cannot tell you in front of everybody. Now I will tell you. She was earning around 22,000 rupees a month. I asked how. She said, I do so many things. Morning, I get in my house, I do this papads and pickles and the usual traditional sales industry the NGOs promote, and then I go supervise, I take contract from Tata. She's such a busy woman. I told her, can you show me the results of the farm pond you're doing? She took me to a village. And that's the interesting part of the story. A nice farm pond, she told me this was just completed 6 months ago. First rainfall, the pond was full. Now the water is low because of summer. It was August last year. Full vegetables around the site. And I asked her to call the tribal and find out how much she must have earned. And she told me, we have calculated, because she runs the tempo which shifts the vegetables to the market. So she knows exactly how many times the tempo has done the trip. So she said, I was very impressed. I thought this can be the project for everybody. If somebody can earn 3 lakhs in 4 months, why not we do it for every tribal? Everybody needs fresh vegetables. And I thought another, like this young woman, a very nicely dressed man in a motorcycle will come. Because the first thing in India, first sign of economic mobility is buy a Hero Honda. Go to any village, you'll see a Hero Honda. Now it is Innovas, because depending on how much you progress. And this man comes tall banyan with a dirty dhoti. I thought, 3 lakh kamane ke baad bhi aisa hi hai. And 3 children in tow, school time. I looked at this woman, a beautiful and well-dressed woman beside me, full knowledge of what she is doing. And this man, and I asked him, kya hua aapko, 3 lakh mein kya kiya aapne? Maalum nahi sir, khatam ho gaya. 4 months is earned 3 lakhs, he doesn't even know where the money is. Now that is what happens, my friends, if you pursue economic growth without building the person to spend the money first, to manage your money. The first case, the tribal woman, her human and social capital was built, now she can manage her economic capital. The second case, economic capital was created with no basic human or social capital. He doesn't even know he got 3 lakhs and how to spend. So again, it substantiated my argument. Let's build the human capital. Build physically, intellectually, emotionally and spiritually. And social capital, we live in a world where we don't trust anybody. It's a funny story. Every time I go to the market, you look at your own lives. I don't know how it is in Varanasi. I remember coming from a very ordinary middle class family, and every evening my father would take me to the market. That was one time I used to love him doing it. Now I can look back and thank him for it. He would talk to me stories, he would talk to me how to live, he gave me the vyavaranyan. And everything, the values that I was created. But you take me to the market, he'll be buying 4 bananas. He'll negotiate as he's buying a house. Now for 4 bananas, 4 rupees, a fellow will say, this, my father will ask for 3 rupees. Or for 4 rupees, he'll ask 6 bananas. Finally, he'll negotiate and buy 5 and come. So I grew up on only negotiation. And then my father would say, no, you always look at the takdi. These fellows will cheat. They'll push it this way, that way. Buying 4 mangoes, we are so focused on the takdi. No, we are always convinced somebody will cheat. You get into a Bangalore auto, everybody is looking only at the meter. Because our Bangalore, for 100% I had omni of your travel in Bangalore, anybody from Bangalore. You are always convinced that auto fellow is a cheat. The meter is doctor. He will take you all around the city and bring you to your house next door. And we can't even trust the small street road seller. We have lost trust in everybody. If your professor says something, you immediately say, how can it be true? Today, you believe Google more than us. You know, in my class, I'm very clear. I tell my students, no laptops, no smartphones. Because even before I speak, they already Googled. Some of you might already Google Angus Madison also, I know. They are like that. So, I tell my students, you can use laptops, and most of them are on Facebook actually. They're pretending to take notes. So, I have a simple rule in my class. I tell them, all laptops are welcome. Within 1 hour of the class finishing, you must email me what I told in class. And that will count for participation grade. After that, no laptop opens now. Because that's a very nice way. Deal with students the way you have to deal with them. But we have no trust in each other. We lost that trust. Students don't trust faculty. Faculty don't trust the management. They don't trust the students. They think every student will copy. Most of the Indian laws are built on mistrust. We expect the citizens to cheat, and the law is made for them. We don't expect the citizens to be honest people at all. We don't make a law for honesty. We don't make a law to promote honesty. We make laws to capture dishonesty, and we don't do it properly also. $16 billion was what was the leakage calculated in India last year. So-called transparent, efficient government of ours. Despite the best efforts made and the top level being clean in this country, we lost $16 billion. If the top level also is corrupt like in previous governments, you can imagine what happened to us. And imagine, we are all driven by dishonesty. We have incentivized and glorified dishonesty so much that we don't incentivize honesty at all. We don't celebrate goodness of mankind, which is what India was doing. We only celebrate, you know, when I was in Lokayukta, I used to tell my Lokayukta, Santosh Hegde, a great man to work with. Now there's no problem in Karnataka because our present chief minister destroyed the Lokayukta itself. The previous chief minister, we sent him to jail. The present fellow thought, if I'm corrupt, they'll send me to jail. So best is to destroy the institution itself. We destroyed the institution itself. I used to tell my Lokayukta, when we capture the corrupt, we put the front photograph in the front page. And make it look as if being corrupt is nice, will come on the front page. How many times we capture a man's honesty and put it on the front page? We don't celebrate goodness at all. And that is what India was known for, my friends. So can we build trust, relationships, reputation, all these are norms of social networks. And the economic consequences, I've actually measured and calculated. My life's work along with my students from Cornell is to look at measuring these indicators. Can we measure them? Can you demonstrate specificity and sensitivity? So the economic consequences of social capital, there are problems also. I'm not saying my theory is perfect. There are a lot of challenges and limitations. There are a lot of things where, because there's no body of knowledge for this at all. We are wrestling with finding out new things. So I believe can create trust with government and citizens and community, within civil society and corporates. 20 years ago, I would have said all corporates are ruthless criminals making money. Well, there are ruthless criminals making money in every sector, even in the NGO sector also. Today, I would say we cannot work without each other. Can we build those partnerships based on trust and interdependence for all the four major players? Government, which is the single largest mover of the economy, people, communities, civil society. Today, we have created an environment of mistrust of civil society groups. Recently, I wrote an article called NGOs and the Future of Civil Society. It is not bright. The way we have made the civil society a monster, the way we have made the NGO sector a corrupt missionary, all NGOs are not corrupt, as much as all politicians are not corrupt, as much as all academicians are not corrupt. In Karnataka, you can buy a PhD in 5 lakhs. That doesn't mean all PhDs in this country are paying 5 lakhs and getting it. So we all know, everywhere the same thing. So I say society has got everybody everywhere. So how do we actually initiate dialogue? How do you build partnerships? That's a new development vision for India. Because we live in a strange country, remember, the world's largest IT capital. 33% of the world's poor lives in India, my friends. We don't even recognize it. Every third poor man is in this country of ours, and it doesn't have to be poor. The top 20% of India generates and controls 85% of India's wealth. 40 Indian families control 40% of India's GDP. Inequity is increasing. You go Google the bread corridor from West Bengal to Kerala, you have a bang. You cannot take care of inequity by killing the rich. Vivekananda said it so beautifully. He said, it is not by pulling down the rich, but only by pushing up the poor can a new India arise. He said, it is not by a revolution, but only by an evolution can an India arise. And that evolution is creating the human and social capital for us. Spirituality in India, remember, a country, an extraordinary country which gives spirituality to the world from a different definition. Revolved on one simple question, the question Ramana Maharishi asked, who am I? If you can just ask ourselves, who am I all the time? I think that is the spirit of self-inquiry, spirituality, and that's what India needs. Emotional capital that we had was managing ourselves and the rest of the world. Interpersonal, intrapersonal intelligence. All of India's education system, if you deconstruct the Gurukula mechanisms, was built from 8 basic human intelligences. Today, Howard Gardner of Harvard University writes about eight basic human intelligences. Every one of them is described in Indian texts. And we don't value it. Whether it's musical intelligence, and everything was taught in the Gurukula. Whether it is mathematical intelligence, whether it is linguistic intelligence, whether it's read and write intelligence, whether it's kinesthetic intelligence, interpersonal intelligence or intrapersonal intelligence, all these are part of the Indian education system which built that human capital. Today, from 7th standard, you go enroll in a Chaitanya or Narayana to get into IIT-BHU. They have no childhood at all. We don't build capital. We think cognitive attainment is enough. Cognitive attainment, my friends, is useless without the emotional growth that your brain needs. Today's neuroscience tells us, if the cortex can take care of your executive functions, the basal part of the brain takes care of your basic functions, and the basic functions have a huge impact on your executive functions. And if I don't teach you meditation, if I don't teach you yoga, you are not growing. Meditation. Today, Harvard Medical School again has published a paper 6 months ago. 10 minutes of meditation every day. Dhyana, as described in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. Every day, just 10 minutes, not too long. Can permanently change you after 8 weeks of sustained practice. Just 8 weeks, 2 months. So, as part of our orientation, we can teach our children yoga and meditation. Remember the power you give them. You're actually making them great people without knowing it. If you can tell them the right food to eat. So, running a program is not just teaching them. It's also about thinking of what they're eating, where they're eating, when they're eating, what exercises they're performing, what kind of reflective thinking we're making them do. If you can create that band, that new generation of people, you think India will have a problem? We'll build an India like Vivekananda said. He said, my dream is to see a resplendent Mother India sitting on with a beautiful crown on the throne of ours, where truly we believe that peace, harmony, democracy, equity are not going to be slogans anymore. It will be something we live. Where there will not even be a single poor man in this country. Vivekananda said, as long as a dog in my country doesn't get food to eat, I will keep working for them. It was not spirituality or religious progress he wanted. It was human progress he wanted. And that is what we should strive for. If we can't build a new country based on this, we'd rather have no country at all. And it is this generation, the young people sitting here. Remember, 58% of you is less than 20 today. 78% of India is less than 40. My generation is gone by. If the 78% of India wakes up and says, I am going to build the human and social capital, nothing can stop our progress. And India should grow not because of India alone. India should grow because we are the only country which never marched against any country. We are the only country where we believe nuclear stockpiling is not an answer. We are the only country which is always giving. We believed in Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. And that can only come from a man who is emotionally mature. And that's what we need human capital for. So if we can do all this, my friends, we can move forward. And then my model, I can keep going on, I'd like to stop. I've created a model which can move forward. And so I believe, like Vivekananda said, a lot of good things were there in the past. There's a lot of bad things also, including our caste system and all that. We need to throw that out. We need to understand, change is not about change at all. In conclusion, I would like to say, change is about understanding what to preserve. The 99% of DNA that made us great is what we need to preserve. The 1% of DNA that is useless, we need to throw it out and reacquire that 1% of DNA where every Indian can proudly say, I'm proud to be Indian. And if we can refashion the development narrative of this country, we'll have extraordinary things to look forward to. If not, the future will be bleak and we'll have nobody but ourselves to blame. And like Vivekananda said, the good things need to be retained. But the India that is to be the future India must be much greater than the ancient India. There's no point just talking about the past if you don't know how to build on it to create a great future. Thank you.